Okay, that was Toby Mac, if guys don't know that. Keeping the theme there with the DC Talk. Hey, I'm coming back at you. This is July 4th, 2023. And we're continuing with dealing with William Bell's 5 points that he tried to debunk premill dispensationalists, but generally just futurism in general is what he's trying to do. I had other thoughts and minds and things like this, but I'm thinking it is probably more important here if we just dive into the material and look at it. Remember the last two videos, he talked about an invisible, but yet reads the word, he appears when he will appear, but claims that he is invisible. And then also bodily, rejects the bodily existence of Christ. And we've shown in Colossians 2:9 that Christ dwells presently in bodily form in heaven. That's how he ascended in bodily form. He is a whole person, body, soul, and spirit. So when he comes, he will come bodily, physically, just as the resurrection of the dead is bodily and physical bodies coming out of the ground, as every example shows that. And his return, of course, is Jesus himself that will appear, which doesn't mean he has to have a body in order to appear. Exodus 24, and it says the Lord God of Israel appeared before these men. They ate and drank with him, and he did not kill them. So you have many times in the Old Testament theophanies, or what they call more correctly a Christophany, where they see Christ who comes in physical form, bodily, as a male. So that doesn't mean he has to have a body. But of course, in the New Testament, he did become a man. He took on human form, which in the incarnation, this remains true. He never gives up his body. There's no scripture that says he doesn't have a body. And the logical progression, as we pointed out, is like in Romans 6:9. Once he is resurrected, he is no longer mortal, no longer subject to death. Well, a spirit is not subject to death. Only the soul the body of the person is subject to death. That is what is mortal. Your soul, your spirit is not mortal. In other words, your soul does not grow old, get sick with diseases, and then dies. Doesn't happen. There's no natural death to your soul. It is only for the body. So mortal, perishable are only applied to the human physical body. Therefore, he says, this body will change. It will take on immortality and imperishability. So when Jesus was raised, he was raised no longer subject to death. And this death was not spiritual death, because Jesus was never subject to spiritual death. This had everything to do with the death of the body that he died the first time in. So once he was raised, he was no longer mortal. He was immortal. But of course, Preston and many others have to deny that. Well, let's get into his point number 4 here. And you can hear.
We're entitled to the inheritance over the national kingdom, which we said earlier, they were to be cast out and would not inherit with them. This,
and then we showed that he talks about the cast out in Matthew 8:11-12, whatever. So no, there's no scattering. The Jews are not cast out. They are gathered together for judgment, killed and burned up like chaff. All right, let's go on.
Was hidden, and they were growing like tares and wheat together. So the text says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called sons of God.
I backed up too far. So let me That's what I did. I didn't go far enough ahead. Let me do that real quick. I don't want to repeat last week's. Yeah, keep going up here. There we go. Let's back it up. Okay, now let's play.
Reason number four, is that you cannot get a literal 1,000 years from Matthew 8, 11, and 12. Now, the premillennial dispensationalist talks about Christ coming to reign on earth in Jerusalem for a literal 1,000 years. However,
Matthew 8, 11, 12, we showed that. I don't know that I need to go back and look at it if you're paying attention, following along. But whoever said that Matthew 8, 11 shows the second appearing of Christ in a literal 1,000 years, it's not there. It's not the second appearing. And you notice he keeps using that word appearing in there, never realizing that if you're saying that Jesus appears a second time, then that means he has to appear where we see him with the eyes and understand with him. But he rejects that. So it's just kind of funny that he continues to use that second appearing language when it...
I guess Matthew 8...
We'll do it. I'm asking, where does it suggest anything about the second coming or anything else? Well, the idea is he will recline the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the sons of the kingdom will be thrown into outer darkness in a place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Okay, recline at the table with that. Where does that actually... I can do it this way. Let me do this way. I'm off the top of my head here, kind of a thing. Banqueting table. If I look that up first, then leave had a great banquet. Banquet, the table, Ezekiel, feast at my banqueting table. Solomon's is definitely there. You prepare banquet for me. Cedric, she has prepared a great banquet. Places of honor. He talks a lot about it. Grab your shields and the vision banquet is ready. And it goes on in different places and talks about the banqueting table. Especially in Solomon. He prepares a meal for me in the presence of my enemies at his banqueting table. And, I hate when this does this. But here's where I want to get to. Revelation 19. Where did we get the idea of a banqueting table? It's here. The judgment true. Judgment, he crept the earth when smoke. 24 elders fell down and worshiped, praise him. Here it is. The marriage supper lamb. Then I heard it would be a great multitude of people, men and women. My tongue. I got to get used to talking again like this. I don't do it very often. Give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready, and it was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. The righteous deeds of the saints. So this is the marriage supper that it's talking about, the marriage of the Lamb. In a marriage supper, and this is, of course, as you go back to Matthew 25, it talks about the marriage. Well, what happens is when two people are getting married in this culture, they party with their families. It's two separate locations. And eventually what happens is, now I'm gonna explain this from a premillennial view. I want you to hear this real close. Historic and scriptures, using scriptures. In the banqueting, in the wedding, well, then what happens is when that is done, they will go to the appointed place where they're going to be living. Or maybe even to their parents' house where the party kind of rages on. So what will happen is the male, father, husband, will go to her house. Word will be sent forth that the king is approaching, that he is coming. They let him know. And what happens is everybody comes outside and meets him And then they all go into the building and the doors are shut. You've heard this multiple times in multiple parables all the way through the Gospels. Jesus talks about a marriage. So when Jesus comes, word is sent forth that he is coming, in the sense of what happens is as he comes, people come out of the grave. He brings with him the dead. We who are alive are changed. We meet him on the road, and he comes in back to earth. That is the second appearing. That's also reiterated on the day of Jesus coming into Jerusalem, Palm Sunday. What happened? Word spread that he was coming. The town poured outside the city, met him on the road, and escorted him in. That is a basic idea all the way across. But getting back to the marriage feast, okay, so once they all go into the house, that is where the marriage takes place. So now the banqueting of Abraham and Isaac is actually, well, they're in heaven right now. There's no doubt about that. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and everybody who's died, Christian in Christ, is in heaven, correct, right now. When are we all going to sit down? And I believe that is in the new Jerusalem, when everything is done, is when we will be sitting down together and eating. Not here at this marriage supper or this kind of a thing. This is just imagery and not literal. In the sense of the marriage, those applications of things in the language. But the literalness, of course, is that Christ comes, we meet him in the air, and we return to earth with him as his army, and go into Revelation 19, the rest of where the rider of the white horse comes. But it shows this thing happening before he comes. There's a meeting that takes place, and that meeting is what I would call, in one sense, the rapture. This is the meeting in the air with him as we go down to the earth, and that battle takes place. I bet you 2-1 there's going to be quite a celebration that happens when that whole thing is over with. So with that, that's what I'm talking about with the Isaac and Jacob meeting with them. Let's go on and hear what he has to say more.
Again, the Bible says Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets sit down with Christ and are raised up to sit with him in the kingdom. All right? That happens when many come from the east and west. That's the time of judgment.
Now, the words never say, does it? Never says anything about being raised up or anything like that. And this is what William Bell continually does, is he adds things to it that's just certainly not there. These are eisegesis. This is reading into the verses and everything else. This is just a simple statement that, think about it. Here's a Gentile centurion that came to Jesus with faith and believed in him, but yet many of his own people who were Jews didn't believe in him. So he makes this basic statement, says, you know, there's going to be a day when many will come from the east, west, all these Gentiles from all over the place are going to sit with us, Abraham, Isaac, and everybody in the kingdom. We're going to sit down together, and they're going to be these Gentiles. But these people, these sons of the kingdom, no, they're not going to sit down. This is after judgment, of course. They're going to be thrown into outer darkness. They're going to be cast out. They're not going to be there with us. So he's making a pointed accusation against them, you know. There's going to be Gentiles there, but it never says when. It never says anything about what, did, you know, the words, they're raised up to sit down with Christ in his kingdom. It just, that's not in there. So he's reading into it more than what needs to be there.
But he tells us also that that's when the sons of the kingdom would be cast out into outer darkness. And that takes us right back to 70 AD. So,
and it doesn't take us back to 70 AD, as we've explained before. There was no judgment in 70 AD, in the Great White Throne. There was a national judgment where God came in, as they did in Babylon. Was there a Great White Throne judgment that happened about? No. The Great White Throne is described as the last judgment of all men. This is a judgment on a nation and a group of people, not on all men. That's the difference. Sodom and Gomorrah, they are waiting. They had national judgment. There's a day now where they are going to stand before God and give an account for what they did. That is the Great White Throne Judgment. and a resurrection. So we know that there was no resurrection that took place in 70 AD because nobody saw it. And it will be seen. I'm sorry. The scriptures are very clear in the examples that it gives. Every resurrection was seen. Matthew 27, many of the saints were raised after his resurrection and appeared to many and walked around in Jerusalem. And yeah, it goes on. That's what resurrection is. Purpose of the resurrection might be different, but as in Lazarus died again, but when we are raised with him, death is destroyed. We no longer die again, which again means what? It implies the fact that it is a physical body that is raised. That is what can die again. The spirit didn't die. It was the body that died, and it cannot die again in that. So let's look at Luke 13:27, head him off at the pass. Whoops. My sticky fingers. Luke, what now? 13:27. We got new internet, so obviously you can tell it goes a whole lot faster. But he would say, I'll tell you, I do not know you, where you come from. Depart from me, all you workers of evil. So they're casting out of darkness, and the place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When you see Abraham rising, taking all the prophets in the kingdom, but you yourselves will be cast out. The people come from east and west, from the north and south, and recline at the table in the kingdom of God. And be some of, hold, some of the last will be first, and some of the first will be last. The judgment and the resurrection. So when they come in there after the judgment, the resurrection. Now, he describes resurrection, of course, as bodies coming out of Hades into heaven. That's not resurrection. That's transmigration of the soul for some people who claim they go into another body or some type of spiritual body. Bible never says that's resurrection. That is not the resurrection. And every priest will say dead ones, the dead ones. But resurrection of the dead is anastasis necron, the standing again of a corpse, a lifeless corpse that is standing again. That means Lazarus, his lifeless corpse stood again. Jesus, his lifeless corpse came back to life and it stood again. So that is consistency. You can't say Jesus is the exception. That's bogus. It is the reality of what it is, and you have to be consistent. That resurrection, all those examples have to be of the same nature. So therefore, the resurrection of the dead is of the same nature. Now, we believe in the 1,000 years. We don't accept Don Preston's and other views. In other words, in order to be an A. Miller Post, which Don Preston is, what they say is that the 1,000 years ends with the destruction of Jerusalem and all that. That is that time when Satan is released and all of that. He claims that is the 1,000 years. That is the perfect time frame. That is the millennium. But you look at the screen there. You cannot get a literal 1,000 years between 30 and 70 AD. The ascension and is coming. But that's what Don Press is teaching. So William Bill here is teaching something different. Well, if it didn't happen before that, then it has to happen afterwards, which makes him pre-mill. By him denying that makes him pre-mill. That means the 1,000 years has to come after the second coming. So you can see this confusion right there from the start. But see, the resurrection takes place, and a judgment against the beast and the world of the ungodly. As 2 Peter says, it's the ungodly that are destroyed in that destruction and those things. But Zechariah 14, it shows the survivors of those other nations. These people build up, because Revelation actually shows you that 2/3 of mankind are destroyed on the earth and killed. Not just from the land, from the whole earth. That context is another argument, I understand. But if 2/3 of Jews were killed, not the ungodly. It doesn't show in 70 AD the ungodly killed, or 2/3 of mankind living in the land of the Roman soldiers and all of them were killed. It never says that. The judgments of the vials that were poured out of the beast in his kingdom, 2/3 of those people are dying That never happened in the Roman Empire in 70 AD. Never did. And that was of the ungodly that were supposed to die, according to scriptures in 2 Peter. But it, in 70 AD, it was only the Jews who were killed, not the ungodly. So that is one type of a judgment. And then at the end of the 1,000 years, Satan is released, gathers the second army, and it says they number as the sand of the sea. There were so many of them, which means somehow or another, these people had to be repopulated. Here's the ungodly. They're still there. And that's when judgment comes down by the fire upon them and destroyed. We all stand before the great white throne judgment. Those that are sinful and all that were cast into the lake of fire. Those that were given their eternal life went into heaven. So there's your great gulf between the two of them. That is considered the outer darkness. In the New Jerusalem, in that there are no sinners running around on the earth because they are all in the lake of fire. All men are judged. There's nobody left to live in the earth. The earth is remade and man comes down. So that is the basic historic premillennial position, not dispensational. So a lot of people try to argue from a dispensation because it's so popular. But trust me, there is a great movement in the dispensation where it's starting to slowly fade away in favor of the historic premillennial idea, where the rapture and the second coming can take place at the same time. All right, so let's go back to and listen to him.
So how can you get a literal 1,000 years between the period of Jesus' ascension and the time that the Jews were cast out, which is what the text says is his second coming? You cannot get a literal 1,000 years between 30 to 70 AD, between the ascension and the coming. And that's why premillennial dispensationalism doesn't work. There is no literal 1,000 years reign taught anywhere in the Bible in terms of the coming of Christ. And then...
Okay, so you just heard that statement. There is no place where the Bible teaches 1,000 years reign or some kind of kingdom reign or whatever. And I've done it. I'm going to keep harping on it. People might not like it, but here. There's a day of judgment there where Jerusalem goes in battle, but on a different day. Not the same day when God goes out on a fight on a day of battle. It is not the same day. When he went after the Babylonians, it was not on the same day the Babylonians destroyed. It was years later that Babylon was destroyed by God's judgment and then the Persian and so forth. But on the day of his coming, verse 4, on this specific day, his feet shall stand on the Mount of Olives that lies before Jerusalem on the east. Then the Lord my God will come and the saints with him. That is, of course, 1 Thessalonians 3:13, as I've stated before. At his coming, he will come with all his holy ones. This is 1 Thessalonians 4. This is the rapture. This is the idea that they're coming with them. Again, even in Revelations 19. This is easier sometimes. Just to, instead of having to go back, I can just use a different thing. So I'll put this one on Revelations. And go back to 19 and show. And you can do this. There you go. I use the ESV because it is the English Standard Version. It is more correct in a literal type of translation from Greek to English. It's more accurate. Okay, but here. So what? Go down. You have 11. Christ comes out of heaven. He's making war. He is clothed in robe dipped in the blood by the name which is called the Word of God. Now the armies of heaven followed after, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. So these are the saints that follow after. And that's who becomes his army. The beasts and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, false prophet, and done signs and did all those things. These two people, number of the man, remember, is 666, so it's a man. these two, false prophet and the beast, were thrown alive. That word actually means while alive, into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur. So they were living when Jesus returned. Nero died in 68, so he cannot be the beast. He was not alive in 70 when, quote unquote, supposedly Jesus came. So who is the false prophet and the beast? Foot predators have no idea. They have guessed and guessed and guessed and guessed, but everything falls through. In this, it shows that Jerusalem is protected by the coming of Christ with his armies. He defeats these armies. Revelation 6 says that this army takes place, this whole battle. Where does it take place? Where? Armageddon. Valley of Megiddo, which is about 100 miles south. Stars fell from sky, vanished kings of earth and great ones, the generals, rich power, and were slave and free, hid themselves. There's the ceiling and the seven trumpets and grapes of wrath and all of that that happens, but that battle takes place. There it is. The hour of the day and the month, the number of the amount of troops were twice 10,000 times 10,000. Let's go. But these plagues, a third of mankind were killed. But these three plagues, a third of mankind was killed. Not Jews. It says mankind. By the fire and the smoke coming out, for the power of the horse in their mouths, serpents and that. The rest of mankind were not killed by these plagues, did not repent of their works, worshiping demons they cannot see or hear, for they did not repent of their murders. So there's that battle that takes place. The two witnesses, the woman and the dragon, the first beast, and there it is. And I looked, behold, a white cloud, seated in the cloud, was like the one Son Man with the golden crown in his hand, a sharp sickle in his hand. There's the coming of Christ. Pick up your sickle, swing. He swings across the earth. The earth was reaped, not just the land. Came the temple in heaven. He had two mega sharp, and it came out. The earth gathered the grapes of the harvest. They threw it in the grain, and the winepress was trodden out of the city, and the blood was flowed from the winepress as high as a horse's bridle. This happens in... I got it. All of a sudden, I forgot. I'm terrible with numbers, but no. How am I? Armageddon. Let's do it that way. Revelation 16:16. Okay, there. So that's where it was at. That's where it's mentioned. That's where this battle takes place. Not outside the walls of Jerusalem, but in the valley of Megiddo. For they are demonic spirits. Assemble them for battle on the great day of God Almighty. The day of his coming. Behold, I'm coming like a thief. See? There it is. Is the one who stays awake, keeping his garments so they're not naked and exposed. And they assembled them at the place that in Hebrew is called Armageddon. What is Armageddon? Let's look at the Greek. And he gathered them together in a place called in Hebrew Armageddon. Harm is the generic way of saying the mountain. Armageddon, a mountain of uncertain location. There is the valley. Armageddon. Megiddon is a place in Manasseh. Where is Manasseh? It is south. I'm not going to bring up the map. You can do that on your own. But the idea is that the battle doesn't take place outside of Jerusalem. It takes place in the Valley of Megiddo. And that's what it happens. So, maybe I'm going too far astray or something like that, but the idea is that still, William Bell does not, I don't remember hearing him, I don't know if I got too far ahead or not, but there's no place in there where it says anything about where he talks about, so when is the 1,000 years? And we're not talking about a literal, if he's trying to make a thing that we believe that it's a literal 1,000 years, and he's saying that it's only 35, 37 years between 33 when he ascended and defeated all Satan's, you know, and then his second coming, you still have it 37 years. How do you get 37 years out of 1,000? And yet, you can go back to Revelations, and what does it say about time frame in Revelations 13? And the beast was given a mouth uttering haughty and blasphemous words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. That's why they claim that it's 70 AD, right? 42 months. It was allowed to make war on the saints, not the Jews, on the saints, and to conquer them. Not the Jews, the saints. In 70 AD, who was conquered? Israel. The Jews, not the saints. That's why it's two different things. And all who dwell on earth will worship the beast. Did all that dwelled on the earth worship the beast? No. Yes, there was Caesar worship that was going on. This beast builds an idol that everybody's supposed to bow down to, remember? He makes the earth and the heavens worship the beast. Mortal blow, great signs, making fire come down from heaven to earth in front of people. Did anything like that happen with Nero or anything? No. But the signs he allowed to work in the presence of the beast to deceive those who dwell on the earth. So was people in Rome deceived by worship this beast, this image? It gave breath to the image of the beast, so the image of the beast might speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. No, that didn't happen. Did everybody have to take a mark on their forehead? Right? No. This is the name of the beast and of its name. Now, I've heard all kinds of pansy-type arguments for that, but calls for wisdom. Let the one who's understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. So it is a man. The beast is a man. He is a person thrown in. Okay, let's continue
1,000 years between 30 to 70 AD, between the ascension and the coming. And that's why premillennial dispensationalism doesn't work. There is no literal 1,000 years reign taught anywhere in the Bible in terms of the coming of Christ.
Oh, I was back, and that's where I got distracted, right? I'm sorry. So Jesus comes and stands on the Mount of Olives. The Lord will be king over all the earth, and on the day the Lord will be one, and his name one. There's his kingdom set up. It shall continue in summer and winter. There's time going after. Then we go down to 60. Then everyone who survives of all the nations that have come against Jerusalem, not the new Jerusalem. There was no idea whatsoever that these armies, literal armies, came against the new Jerusalem. That is so bogus of an interpretation from Don President. It's not even funny. They will go up year after year to worship the king. Year after year. There's your time frame where Christ sets up a millennial kingdom. And that's when it happens, where the saints rule with him. They are raised. This all comes from Revelations 20. When the 1,000 years was ended, Satan is released from his prison, will go out and deceive the nations, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea. They march over the broad plain of the earth and surround the camp of the saints. The camp of the saints. So now, Jerusalem, the beloved city, is the camp of the saints. Was 70 AD the camp of the saints? No. They fled. So how do you get Jerusalem being the camp of the state, the beloved city is Jerusalem. It's not the New Jerusalem. Again, that's what they'll insert there. That's the New Jerusalem. Oh, so the New Jerusalem came down while during the millennium, and now Satan is free to run on the earth, and he gathers all this army from all these people because all these ungodly people are living. and they attack Jerusalem again, you know, and they attack Jerusalem. And they're only destroying Jerusalem, the beloved city, where all the camp of the saints. See, it doesn't work. And the idea is camp. That is the word barracks, where an army dwells. What army of the saints? Well, the ones that came with them in 19. That's who they are. They're the ones dwelling and ruling with him. Oh, wait, did I get ahead of myself? I saw the souls who had been beheaded by the beast, by the, you know, worship the beast and all that, who had their marks on. So what happened to those people that were dead, those souls beheaded? They came to life. This is the saints' vindication. They come back to life, and they reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. So they're going to reign with Christ when he comes on the earth. They marched over the blood plain, camp of the saints, beloved city. So this raising to life is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who shares in the first resurrection. Over this, such the second death has no power. But they will be praising God in Christ, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years. So it says it there twice, doesn't it? So when it's over, when the 1,000 years are ended, Satan is released, gathers an army. They march over across the plain, broad plain of the earth, surround Jerusalem, the camp of the saints. But fire comes down from heaven, just like in 2 Peter 3, and consumes them. And the devil who deceived him was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet were. Now, it's not quite accurate in the Greek, but the idea, it comes across. They're being thrown into the lake of fire. The beast and the false prophet, when were they thrown into the lake of fire? When Jesus came. He threw them in there while alive. They will be tormented day and night. And then, if all the ungodly now are all killed, all over the whole world, then the judgment takes place. Everybody stands before the judgment seat and is judged according to the books. Do we have time? Do we, or should we go into a next one? Yeah, let's not make this one forever long. I will end this one right here, and we'll do number 5. Thanks for listening. Thanks for coming back, and we'll see you on the flip side. That sounds familiar, don't it? Oh, well.